Here at St. Petersburg College, we are just extremely excited to have Mr. Prager here. It is an honor, and after speaking with him backstage, you guys are definitely in for a treat. Now, Dennis Prager is a national syndicated columnist and bestselling author. He is the host of the Dennis Prager Show, a worldwide lecturer on a variety of topics, including personal and social issues, morality, and religion. He has appeared on numerous television programs, including the CBS Evening News and the Today Show. Dennis Prager is also a visiting fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University. Now, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Mr. Dennis Prager to the stage.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Wow. Well, given that ovation, I'll just take questions. Why bother with the lecture? I'm very touched. Thank you very much. It's always a little intimidating when people like you in advance. Then you have to live up to something. It's a bit of a burden. Dr. White, thank you so much for making this possible. Thank you, Denny Ann, and the student government. That meant a lot to me that the students wanted me. Everybody knows you want the next generation to take your work seriously. What is it they once said about any author? They would trade in 100 readers today for one reader 100 years from now. And I understand that with my fifth book coming out in 3 weeks. I would like 100 now and 100 in 100 years, actually. I don't want to get you off the hook and say, well, Prager wants a reader 100 years from now, I won't bother. But I am very touched that the students played a big role. So thank you for having me. I was listening to Denny Ann because you might think that introductions are an easy thing to give. That is not true. I will just share with you one given to me by a student about 10, 12 years ago at the University of Colorado, Colorado University at Boulder. And she was very nervous, and she announced to the audience that this was the first time she was speaking publicly, which became evident very quickly. And she was actually reading from a little bio of me, and the bio said, Dennis Prager, that the Los Angeles Times has written that Dennis Prager is obsessed with good and evil. Which is fine, that's true, I am obsessed with good and evil. But she introduced me as a Dennis Prager who is obsessed with doing evil. Unfortunately, the first thing I thought was, how does she know? No. That's not true. I'm naughty, but not evil. So there's a very big difference, as most of you know. So anyway, ever since then, I have been very, very careful to listen carefully and know. So thank you, Denny Ann, and again, thank you to the students. I'm going to talk to you about happiness, and you might wonder, maybe you don't, but you should, or many would, why would the ethics department, and God bless this college for having an ethics department and ethics classes. It is so necessary. It's a beacon, St. Petersburg College, from everything that I have been able to learn about it. And why would somebody speak about happiness under the rubric of ethics? You would think that if anybody were brought in, if a department were to bring somebody in to speak about happiness, it would be the psychology department or perhaps the philosophy department. But why the ethics department? But that is entirely correct. Because what I have to bring to the issue that has been written about and spoken about so often, I have something a little different, or perhaps even a lot different, to bring to this discussion. And that is that happiness is not a psychological state or a feeling as much as it is a moral obligation. And this is what I never tire of speaking about, because I believe that if people took this seriously, it would change the world. And that's a big terminology, a big term, but it is true. It would change everything. It would change the micro. Those of you who hear my radio show know I think in terms of micro and macro. Micro is the personal, macro is the global, the philosophical, et cetera, the things that are society-wide. It changes both totally. And the easiest way that I have, if I'm given 1 minute to explain why it's a moral obligation to be as happy as possible and at least to act as happy as possible, and I will be emphasizing the actions in the talk, but the biggest reason or the easiest way to explain the reason is to ask anybody who was raised by an unhappy parent. Anybody raised by an unhappy parent. Doesn't have to be both parents. In fact, it usually isn't, as I will explain in a moment. Ask them what it was like to be raised by an unhappy parent, and immediately you will understand why I say it's a moral obligation, that we owe it to others to be as happy as possible. Ask anybody married to an unhappy person what that is like. And then, for those of you unmarried students, I presume most of the students are not married, the laughter you heard was a bittersweet laughter. It was the laughter of unfortunate recognition. So let me explain why, to those who don't know. Most people are married to a moody person. Most marriages are intermarriages. A moody and a non-moody have married. On rare occasions, a non-moody, excuse me, a non-moody and a non-moody marry, very rarely. Never has a moody married a moody. So there is something to be said about that, and that is this. The moody may be miserable, but they're not stupid. They never marry one of their own. Isn't that amazing? I mean, think of all the couples you who know couples know. There's no Moody married to the, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Moody. You know, it doesn't happen. What you have, though, is a Moody and a non-Moody, which, by the way, leads to a very interesting question. We all know why the Moody marry the non-Moody. They're not stupid. But why do the non-Moody marry the Moody? Are they stupid? It's a very interesting question. And by the way, I have grappled with it a good part of my life, thinking this issue through. Why does a non-moody marry a moody? Everybody prefers non-moody people. Everybody. The moody prefer it. The non-moody prefer it. So then why? And I think that a part of it, a big part of it, is that a lot of the happier amongst us want to make others happy. And we think that when we marry the moody, we will change them. What generally happens is we get changed. Because after a while, the happy are worn down. And while you're laughing, and it's good that you are, because you know one of my mottos is it's, you know, we have two choices here, to laugh or to cry, and I much prefer laughing to crying. But it's a very serious and very sad subject. Because moody spouses hurt marriages and sometimes kill the marriage. The marriage may go on, but it's still killed. That's why I beg the moody, I beg you, it comes from the sincerest, deepest part of my heart as well as my mind, to change your behavior. I'm not asking you to change your feelings, but I am asking you to monitor your behavior. Because of the effects that it does have on the person that you're married to. It's a real obligation. I feel the obligation. I already said to children, I spoke about to spouses, let's continue the family and then we'll go to non-family, to your parents. As a parent, let me say, and every one of you who is a parent knows, you can have 12 children. If one is miserable, it affects you. What is the old saying? A parent is no happier than their least happy child. There's some truth to that. By the way, my advice to parents is not to allow that dictum to reign in your life. At a given point, you have to say, my daughter, my son is unhappy or miserable or whatever. I'm sorry. Or as one caller said to me on my show, and I just have to say a thank you to my callers, because as much as I hope people have learned from me, I promise you I have learned from callers and emailers to me. People have opened their hearts in email. I mean, people have told me things they don't tell their spouses. That is how open people have felt they could be with me, in part because I'm very open. And a caller called up and she said, I have a daughter, I think about 30 years old, I don't remember, but you know, well into adulthood. And she said, I finally decided, Dennis, the following. I didn't break her, I can't fix her. That was brilliant. That was truly an insight. If your adult child is miserable, you didn't do it. Okay? Maybe when they're six, you have responsibility for how happy they are. Maybe. That's a maybe. But at 30, they have responsibility for whether they're unhappy or happy. At what age does it end? I'll never forget. This is a new thing in life, by the way, holding adults of your childhood responsible. Now, I'm not talking about children who were molested and so on. Most people are not molested. Too many are, but still most are not. I'm just talking about the normal parent who is human and therefore frail and has his or her own issues, just as your parents and grandparents and great-grandparents do. I remember my first radio was in Los Angeles, where I live, and I was the moderator of a very, very popular show on Sunday evenings. And it was on the ABC radio station in Los Angeles, had a very big audience, and it was where I was the moderator of a priest, a rabbi, and a minister each week, different ones each week. I did it for 10 years. I loved every minute of those 10 years, loved it. One of the things I learned, which is worthy of its own lecture if you want to have me back, is sometimes I actually said, you know what, we should rename this show. The show was called Religion on the Line. I said, we should rename it to the Ex-Catholic Hour. it was like a new world had opened to me about, and I say this with love and respect, as any of you know, how many people are still walking around at 80, angry at their nuns for wrapping their knuckles when they were 11. You know, I'm Jewish, and you know, none of the rabbis at my Jewish school ever wrapped my knuckles. One threw me over two desks, however. I just want you to know that. They, you know, no, rulers was nothing, you know. And that was it. And by the way, let me just tell the students here, not only was that allowed when I was a kid, if I told my parents the rabbi threw me over two desks, they would have thrown me over three desks. So I never told them. Now, let me really drive the students nuts. I thought he was right. I didn't think of going to personnel. There was no personnel. There was just another rabbi who would have asked, what did you do to cause the rabbi to do that? It was a different world, and in some ways worse, but in a lot of ways better, undoubtedly. And so this was a different way of raising people. And so you have these Catholics who were still telling me 70 years later that, well, they're still bitter at the church because the nun wrapped their knuckles or whatever. And I said, sir, you know, it's time to grow up at 80. with all respect, I don't think you should measure a 2,000-year institution by the nun when you were 11. Just a thought. Just, you know, might want to consider it before you die. And so it was just an amazing thing to witness. So we live in this age of, it's not teachers, it was my clergy, it was some adult. That's nonsense. As true as it is, it's still nonsense. Of course, parents have an effect on you. I'm not a nut. Of course, that's true. But it's time for you to have an effect on you. That's the point of becoming an adult. Hello, I am an adult. I no longer hold my parents responsible. That is the way it should be. By the way, in that regard, I have to say, I understand that Wall Street Journal had an article a number of years ago, how many non-Jews are now having bar mitzvahs. And it's become a, no, it has a very interesting thing, and I totally recommend it. When I was 13, you will find this fascinating, whatever your religion or no religion. When you, what is bar mitzvah mean? Most people don't know this. Most Jews don't even know this, but more Jews know this than non-Jews. 13 means you become, in a male, you become a man. 12, you become a woman. Do you know what the parent says in synagogue at that great moment? They say a blessing to God that I am no longer the one who pays for the sins of my child. That is what it means. So at 13, I knew if I mess up, I answer to God, not they. That's a very transformative moment. Wow, you mean if I cheat on a test, I can't blame my parents? If I rob a convenience store, I can't say my parents messed me up? If I bully a kid in school, I can't say, well, you know, I didn't have good parents. That's right. Can't say it. You can say it all you like, but it doesn't count. This notion, by the way, what does this have to do with happiness, to get back to the theme here, is that you can't be happy until you take responsibility for your life. That's the point. Any therapist who keeps blaming the parents after the first three sessions, blame anybody you want. By session four, if he's not telling you or she's not telling you you're responsible for your misery, you are wasting your money. Worse than wasting your money, you're actually doing harm to yourself. First three sessions, you could blame your parents all you like. Then it's time for you to grow up and take your own life into your hands. The captain of a ship is happier than the person who thinks they have no say in where it is moving. Be the captain of your own ship. So, back to the moral obligation in the micro realm. So I began with spouse to spouse, parent to child. Parents owe children to be happy. Do you know what my son, I'll never forget, my older son, said at my 50th birthday party, we had a, I don't know why I had it. I was miserable, but I didn't show it. I didn't inflict anybody. But I thought at 50, you know, now the countdown is to death. Until now it was till adulthood, you know, it like, and then that. All right. Anyway, I had this birthday party, big birthday party. So my older son got up, and you know what he said? And he was a teenager, which, you know, teens are not thrilled with their parents almost by definition. So I even said, David, you know, it's totally up to you if you want to speak. And he knew I meant it. If he didn't want to speak, he didn't have to speak, and that was fine. The younger one was too young. And so the older one got up, and he said, I just want to say, I want to thank my father for one thing more than anything else. And I had no idea what he would say. And it brought tears to my eyes that he's always happy. And I had no idea what he would say. I thought, you know, that he's given me a nice life, he's been loving this, nothing. That made such an impact on him. That it does, you have, the moody don't realize the impact that they have on those around them. So this is parent to child, spouse to spouse, child to parent, because of the infliction of pain on a parent if you are unhappy, chronically unhappy, moody, etc. That's the family. Now let's go to the non-family, co-workers. I have co-workers, even though in almost the loneliest job in the world as a talk show host, I tell you how lonely it is. It's, you will appreciate this from the answer that I give to young people who say, you know, I'd love to be a talk show host, what do I do? I said, oh, I'll tell you what you do. I want you to go into a room periodically, alone, and be interesting for 3 hours. If you can do that, you got the makings of a talk show host. It takes a slightly perverse personality to actually be able to do that. I did my last 2 days of broadcast. I was in Connecticut giving a lecture. I came here from the New York area. And I actually broadcast. I carry this machine. I broadcast from my hotel room. I mean, there was nobody. I promise there was nobody in my hotel room. Sounds funny. Nobody was in my hotel room except me, and, you know, but I was trying to still be funny and alive and enthusiastic and so on. But the fact is, when I am at the home studio in Los Angeles, I have an engineer, I have a producer, and so that's at least two people who are present. And in that area of the station are two others who work in that area, who are not working on my show, but on other shows of the station. And I know that my cheerful mood has had a profound impact on all of them. But here is the more dramatic thing. And it's one of the only things that I wouldn't say on radio that I will say outside of radio. And that is, we have an engineer. The engineer is extremely important to a show, extremely important. Whatever you hear goes through them, all the sound effects, the in and out, the telling me how much time I have left, signaling to me when I go back on. They do a tremendous amount. In the past, and this is not to badmouth anybody, but I've never had a cheerful engineer. He is. And he has actually, and I am almost ashamed to admit this, he has affected the show. The show is better because my engineer is happy. How is that for power? The power of a happy person. You'd think, I mean, a show is a show. So the guy's not happy back there. What? It makes a huge difference. I come across livelier. I come across happier, more enthusiastic. As much as I was in the past, I am more so thanks to him. That's the power with your coworker. You change the work area based on your mood. Whatever your work is, whatever your work is. I believe this is true everywhere. I think it's true in the elevator. I have a moral compunction, or moral compulsion, I should say, to cheer my fellow elevator riders. I do. Now, I know that in about 5%, 1 out of 20 times, my attempt will fail and the person will immediately get off the elevator in fear. That may happen. I don't care. For the other 19, it is worth it. And I will make jokes. What else happens in an elevator, right? What do people do? They stand still as Lot's wife. They're pillars of salt in the elevator, and looking at the diode numbers light up. And folks, let's be honest, what is there to look at? Are you wondering what's going to come after 4? Look at that, 5. Oh, I can't believe it. People stare at that more than at the Keno board in Vegas. I often think, so I will say, are you betting on those numbers? You know, or something like that. And, you know, some people will start laughing. And I go, you know, so whatever it might be, or I will be the guy to press the buttons because I was in first, and I will say, what floor, what floor, what floor? And then I will say, just want you to know, I am the new elevator man here in the building. I hope you'll put in a good word with management. So I have rehearsed lines even to make it fun. And it's very sweet to see people start smiling. It's a gift that I have given to total strangers for 30 seconds. But it's a big gift. And it's a gift, the gift of a happy disposition is a gift to all who come in contact with you. I live on airplanes, almost literally. And I don't expect nor want to talk to the passenger next to me. I have a lot of work to do. But I expect to say something, like, hello, good morning. And I will always ask, you know, are you from here? Are you from where we're flying to? Ask a couple of questions and then go back to my work. The person who doesn't answer makes the flight more tense. Right? Oh, no, I'm glad you feel similarly. Of course you feel similarly. Why would you not? So I could stop now. And I think I would have made a compelling case for the need to act happy however you feel. And I will talk to that issue of despite your feelings momentarily. But I haven't made the full case, I've made half. Now I'm gonna make the other half. I made the micro case. The micro is the people in our life. I have a macro case to make for happiness. And that is the happy, if you hear my happiness hour on either of my stations here in Sarasota or Tampa, every Friday, my second hour, Eastern Coast time, that'll be 1 o'clock. And I make the statement, why do I devote an hour each week, even the week of 9/11 on Friday? I did not cancel my happiness hour. I figured if there's any week that needs the happiness hour, it was this week. And I say, the happy make the world better, and the unhappy make the world worse. Not just their parents, their children, and their spouse, and their coworker, and their elevator passengers. The world. Happy people make the world better, the unhappy make it worse. Think for a moment. Do you think to take the current obvious evil of Islamist terror bombers, do you think the happiest Muslims join? I am so happy today. It is great to be alive. I'm going to kill myself. Right? Clearly not the happiest. Did the happiest Germans join the Nazi party? Oh, I'm in such a great mood. I'm going to be a Nazi. I love humanity. I love life. I'm going to be a Nazi. I mean, it doesn't happen. Did the happiest people who joined the Ku Klux Klan, were they the happiest? Oh, I can't wait. What a great life. I'm going to put a sheet over my head. This is happiness. No, I mean, think about it. Think about your own life. When do you most want to bring joy to others? When you are the happiest. If something good happens to you, you want good to happen to others. So it's a very, very big deal with regard to how we affect the world, not just how we affect the people in our lives. Now do you see why I say with absolute seriousness it's a moral obligation? It is so much a moral obligation that it is become in my life something that I now admire when I meet people with happy dispositions. By the way, whether they're 15 or 85, every age has a battle to be happy, every age. You know that, I mean, teens are notorious. Teens are notorious, right, for angst. And oh, woe unto me, my parents, my siblings, my life, woe unto me, my teachers. I don't know what I'm gonna be, I'm confused. My boyfriend doesn't like me, my girlfriend doesn't like me, I've been bullied, like it's brand new bullying and a brand new problem for young people. You know, what are there, 11 Americans who were not bullied when they were kids? The only reason I wasn't bullied is I was born 6'4". I mean, who's gonna pick on me? But everybody's bullied. It's not defensible, but it's universal. And it should be stopped, but I think we're still, there's a certain hysteria over it, but that's a separate issue for another time. And this is how we should be in life. This is how we have to regard it and how we have to act. Let me tell you about the transformation in my own life on this matter. I did not always believe happiness was a moral issue. It never even occurred to me. I thought happiness was exactly what most people think it is, a feeling. You feel happy, you don't feel happy. Not only that, but I was certain that people who lectured and wrote on happiness were basically snake oil salesmen, that the only people who got happier thanks to these books and lectures on happiness were the people who got paid to write books and lecture on happiness. What a deal. I'm happy, why aren't you? As you cash your royalty check or your speaking check. That's the way I viewed it. But life teaches you a lot of things if you allow it to. That's a big if. So about 22 years ago, I was invited to UCLA by the rabbi of UC. You know, there's a priest, there's a minister, you know, who minister to the kids of their religion. So a rabbi at UCLA called me up, said, Dennis, because I had written two books on Judaism prior to my other books. So he said, Dennis, the kids know you from the radio. I'd like you to come and speak here to the Jewish kids at UCLA. I said, oh, Rabbi, I'd be honored. I assume you want me to speak on religion or on Judaism. He said, oh, no, nobody will show up. Which is a sad truth, and I acknowledged that immediately. I said, so what do you want me to speak on? He said, he said something, what was it, what did he say? So he said something happy. I said, like what? He said, well, happiness. And I said, well, but happiness is a serious problem. And to which he said, great title. That's how my book got its title, from the first lecture I gave on happiness, from the rabbi's response to me about what a great title, happiness is a serious problem. He wanted me to speak on something light. I said, it was like what? He said, happiness. And I said, no, happiness is not light. Happiness is a serious problem. Great title. I gave the speech. I prepared very strongly because I was sure it's the only time I'll ever speak on happiness. And I gave the speech. And I liked it so much, if I may say, I did something I had never done before and have never done since, and I have given thousands of lectures. I listened to the lecture after I gave it. And I liked it so much, I kept saying to myself, good point. That is a good point. I'm going to adopt that in my own life. It was as if I was listening to Joe Schmo over there. I wasn't listening to me. That's how good it was and how it affected me. And so what I did was, then and today, people subscribe to my lectures. They used to get them first on cassette, then on CD, now on CD or download. And you get about every other month the best lectures that I give, I record, and we make it available for people who want to get them. So that was it. I was sure that this was the end of my happiness speaking career. 6 months later, I got a call from the literary editor or articles editor of Red Book magazine, the woman's magazine. It's still published. And I get the phone, I pick up the phone, I say, hello, is this Dennis Prager? I said, yes, Dennis Prager, who speaks on happiness? I said, well, I gave one speech. She said, I heard your speech. I am the literary editor of Red Book magazine, and I'm in New York. I said, really? It was not a good salesman for me. The whole time I was shocked. So I said, really? She said, yeah. I said, oh, do you subscribe to my lectures? She said, I never heard of you in my life. I said, I didn't even know you, I didn't know anything, but I heard you on New York radio. I said, you heard me on New York radio? She said, you didn't know? It turns out that a local station there, no longer in existence, for good reason, did something completely illegal, not to mention in our ethics department, unethical. They broadcast the entire hour speech. They never, not only didn't pay me, they never even asked my permission. However, these crooks did the greatest favor for me ever done professionally. So I said, oh, really? Wow. She said, well, I was so impressed. I sat in my car on a cold New York night in front of my apartment building to find out who is this person. Thank God at least the station announced it was me and not one of the guys at the station. You know, I could see them doing it. So she looked, she find me. This is, you know, pre-internet. It was. She looked, she searched, finally found me. So she said, would you write an article for Red Book on happiness? And I said, well, I guess so. Again, not, I didn't know what to say. I don't know. I don't even know. I had one speech. Do I have an article? And then she said, oh, good. How is $3,000? And I give you my word of honor. What went through my mind? I was right. Who gets happy? That's right. I had never felt so confirmed in a view in my life. Folks, let me explain to you. I had written prior to that for places like Commentary Magazine, a very serious journal of politics and thought. You know what I got paid for writing for Commentary? 6 copies of Commentary. That was it. They came in the mail, nice, freshly printed 6 copies to give to friends to show that I was printed. So that's what I was used to. $3,000 22 years ago. What is that, $100,000 today? I mean, you know. So I said, yeah, no, that's fine, that's fine. I mean, the woman could have said $11, I would have said fine. $3,000, that's months of mortgage. That's how I looked at it, because in LA, that's how you think. Will it cover my mortgage? And so I wrote it, and then I was sure that's it. After it was printed, Reader's Digest called me. Can we abridge your article in our international editions? And I thought, and I really was excited. You know, me in Finnish? You know, I Spanish, Portuguese? I was very excited. I said, of course, go right ahead. Then I got a call from the guy who had been my book agent for my first 2 books. And he said, Dennis, I'm getting calls from publishers. He said, really, for what? I didn't even know what he was referring to, for a book on happiness. I said, you gotta be kidding, Richard. I'm lucky I had one speech in me and one article. I don't have a book. He said, Dennis, it really had an impact. I said, I'll tell you what, Richard, I'll give a course in LA on happiness. If I think that I had enough to say in 8 sessions of 1.5 hours each, that's 12 hours, and I don't bull, so it's not fat. If I have 12 hours of substance, I'll write you a book. I gave the course, so Richard calls me back. Well, what do you say? I said, I'm still not convinced. I need to give 16 sessions. And then I gave a 16-session course in LA on happiness. And then I thought, wow, people are being affected here, and I have a lot to say. Okay, so I decided I'd write the book. Random House contracted me for the book. They sent me an advance. I did not write the advance within the years given because I still didn't feel I had a book, and I sent them their money back, which is not easy because I spent it within a week. And so, you know, who doesn't? What, keep it in my pillow until I write the book? So I sent them their money back, and then 10 years later, HarperCollins published the book, Happiness is a Serious Problem. Here's the point. I was transformed over the course of this time into having a belief that it was just a psychological state to realizing this is a very serious and important subject and that it had massive moral connotations. And that's, I was transformed against my own instinct to think of this as a moral obligation. Now let me talk to you about the key here, and that is behavior over feelings. And on occasion I have given this talk to students, and this is the hardest part for a lot of young Americans to fully accept. And anyone who has a problem with this, I am used to being differed with, have no fear, I will treat you with utmost respect. I would love anybody with, or obviously anyone who's not a student, who has a problem with it to speak up. Here is the key. The only people who care if I feel happy are really, or were really, my parents, my wife, and in other words, my friends and my kids. That's it. And maybe if you have a therapist, your therapist. Because they don't want you to be that happy, they lose you. So that was just a dig, it was kidding. So here's the story. Approximately 6 people on Earth care if you're happy. The other 6 billion don't. Everybody else only cares how you act. Okay? Very few people care how you feel, and you don't care about how everybody else feels. You care how they act. If the guy next to me on the plane is feeling bad but acts nicely to me, I'm sorry that he feels bad, but I can't do anything about it. But how he acts is what matters. In all of life, actions matter more than feelings. All of life. This is if I try to have, and those of you who know me from radio, I try to offer good messages every single day. But if somebody were to push me into a corner and say, what is the biggest single message you have to give? It is that behavior is more important than feelings. That might not have been the message 100 years ago or 1,000 years ago, but it is the most needed message today. We live in a feelings-based society, and it is killing us. Killing us. How do you feel about it? How do you feel about it has substituted for is it right or is it wrong? And that is the end of ethics. There are no ethics. Either there are ethics that are independent of what you feel, or there are no ethics. Then we should just call it what it is, feelings. I feel that it is important to build hospitals. They feel that it is important to kill children. What's the difference? It's my feeling against theirs. By the way, talking to college students for the last decades, that is the answer most give. When I say, well, so if it's all a matter of feelings, then how do you know that the Nazis were bad? Or any of the other mass murdering, genocidal groups? How do you know? Said, we don't know. It's our opinion. So it's your opinion versus Hitler's opinion. Correct. One man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. That's what you learn at college, at most colleges. I suspect not this one. But it's sincerely. But that's what you will learn at most colleges. Yeah, well, they call this group a terrorist, but others see them as freedom fighters. So what? So what? The Nazis called the freedom fighters terrorists. Would you not call the French underground freedom fighters because others had a different opinion? Feelings are everything. Would you save your dog or a stranger if both were drowning? I've asked this since I first began lecturing. And 2/3 of Americans that I ask say, certainly people at college age and high school age, and now they're now parents and well into their middle age. And 2/3 don't vote for the stranger. I love my dog, I don't love the stranger, and I follow love. What's bigger than love? Well, I'll tell you what's bigger than love, values. There's a lot that's bigger than love. I love my dogs more than I love any of you, with all respect. But let me just tell you this, if you were swimming and my dog was swimming and you were drowning and my dog was drowning, I'd save you. It wouldn't be a question. Because I wouldn't let my feelings guide me, I would let my values guide me. God help us if we let feelings guide us. They are the worst guide to what is right. The heart is the seat of passion, emotion, appetite. It's great. I love feelings. Otherwise, we're not human if we don't have feelings. Just don't let them guide you morally. That's all. By the way, for those of you who want to ask, let me already answer the question. Well, Dennis, what if Hitler and a dog were drowning? Okay, so let me answer that. Forget the dog. If Hitler were drowning alone, I would throw in a cinder block. So it's not a question. You're free to ask anything you like, but I know I'm going to get that one, so I just figured I'd answer it now. The issue is stranger. I don't know who the stranger is. That's what stranger means. Feelings are not a good guide to anything, including to happiness. Most of us are a roller coaster in terms of feelings. If you were to chart how you felt in terms of happiness in the course of a week, you would look like a schizophrenic. Something gets you down, you didn't get enough sleep, you're down. Something bad happened at work, you're down. Something good happened at work, you're up. Your kid said something hurtful, you're down. Your kid said, "Daddy, I love you," you're up. Right? That's how it works. So then nobody's happy or unhappy. Everybody's both. By the way, everybody is both in terms of feelings. That's the way it is. As the late dear mother of my high school friend, Joseph Telushkin, with whom I wrote my first two books, we were in high school together in Brooklyn, New York. We were sitting in her kitchen. She was what I call a philosopher housewife. Very bright woman. So we were talking about the kids in class we thought were happy or not. She overheard the discussion, closed the refrigerator door, and said, "Boys, let me tell you something. The only happy people I know are people I don't know well." I want that to sink in. I will say nothing for a moment. It's brilliant. It was a brilliant line. The only happy people I know are people I don't know well. What was she saying? She wasn't saying the literal sense that there were no happy people on earth. But she was saying that the more you know about anyone, the more you know how much pain they have in their life. That's what she's saying. So the people you think are walking around happy-go-lucky, life's just a blast, you don't know them. You don't know their pains. You don't know their demons. How is it so often I have heard from a couple that their best friends divorced and they were shocked? How are you shocked about your best friend's marriage being so awful? Don't know. It really shocked us. Because people didn't level about that. It doesn't matter what it is. Do you know the demons that afflict any given individual? Money, envy, sex. I mean, the list is endless of the demons that are in anybody. Alcohol, drugs are the obvious ones. There are less obvious ones. Or the pain that people still feel over, yes, there is real pain from childhood that people still feel. My wife was raised by a man who told her that she was stupid and ugly. With all candor, she's beautiful and brilliant. Didn't matter. Didn't matter. I call myself the anti-Jim. That's what I call, I am the anti-Jim in her life. I'm being totally open with you about my own marriage. Because all I keep telling her is how beautiful and how brilliant she is, which is a fact. I mean, to me, it's as much a fact as the earth is round. But when you have your parents' voice in you the rest of your life, see, I understand that parents can mess around with you, but she didn't allow that to dictate her life, but it still messes up with her feelings and psyche. That voice can never really leave. I understand that. But you would never know that if you met her. It would be inconceivable to you. Or in my life, or in anybody else's life. That's why, by the way, when you know how true that line from the late Helen Telushkin is, you will never envy anyone. Never. And envy is one of the most corrosive things regarding happiness. You won't envy because you don't know what's going on. You have no clue. And the more you know about people, the more you know how much pain there is. That is why the moody and the unhappy walk around thinking that those who walk around happy didn't have their pain. Baloney. Baloney. Let me tell you, you're wrong. A lot of the people you meet who act happy have had it worse than you. That's the point. And you need to know that. I'll never forget. This was during the book tour for this book, which was 12 years ago, Happiness is a Serious Problem, I went to a station, and I won't even say where it was, because the person is still broadcasting and is very popular in that part of the country. And he was quite young then, in his 30s, and he was a big, big hit in a major city in this country. And I went on a show to talk about my book, And I saw a picture on his desk of a very beautiful young woman and beautiful children. And I said, is that your wife and children? He said, yes. And I remember thinking, this guy has it all. In other words, I had a reaction against my own mind and what I had written in my book. This guy has it all. Great career, he's a big hit at this age, doing well, beautiful wife, beautiful kids. And then in the course, this was the beginning of the internet being really popular. We were talking about our mutual love of the internet. So I said, I'll tell you, you have no idea. I put in multiple sclerosis and you have no idea how much I learn. I said, well, why do you put in multiple sclerosis? Because my wife has it. And then I remember thinking, Dennis, you're an idiot. I really do. I lacerated myself. Dennis, you violated your own rule. You didn't know anything except the picture. And on that picture, you know how many young girls think that these actresses in Hollywood, I mean, I live in LA. You know, we see them come, you know, so to speak, Greyhound bus and airplane after airplane coming because they so believe that the starlet's life is a happy life. Read any, virtually any memoir of a major Hollywood star, and you will read about among the unhappiest lives you have ever read. The number of happy stars is very small, not very large. But understandably, you see them beaming at the Academy Awards, and then they say the thing that I most hate. The woman wins the Academy Award, and then she says with utter sincerity, I just want to tell all the young women of this country, all the girls of this country, you just follow your star, and you will succeed like I did. But it's not true. One woman a year wins Best Actress. One wins Best Supporting Actress, and that's it. There are 150 million females in the country, two win an Academy Award. It's not good advice. Follow your star maybe, but you're not gonna end up here. You will end up as a waitress on Sunset Boulevard. It's like a routine thing I do with everyone. I ever have a waiter or waitress in LA. I said, so I take it you're an actor? Yeah, that's right. And that's fine, I respect them, they're working. I respect them completely. But I just want you to know that 99% of those who follow their star to Hollywood are waitressing and waiting. And that's fine too. But reality is important. So, behavior is what matters, not the feeling, because everybody's filled with pain, everybody's filled with dark feelings, everybody has what Chaim Potok, the great novelist, late novelist, wrote with the 3 a.m. questions. You know, you wake up or you can't sleep at night, what are you thinking, happy thoughts? Who thinks happy thoughts at 3 a.m.? Anybody ever awaken from laughing? What a treat. It was hilarious. I'm so sad I got up. I don't remember having a happy dream ever. And if you have a happy dream, it's one in a million. I mean, who dreams happy things? There's a lot of darkness in all of us. That's why how you behave matters. So, here is the $64,000 question objection. Isn't that inauthentic? This is the question that I posed, especially young people who have latched on to the charge of hypocrisy when meeting adults. If you don't act how you feel, you're a hypocrite. Here's the answer. If you don't act how you feel, you are an adult. And it's good to be an adult. It's more fun to be an adult than to be a child. Every adult who is an adult and who doesn't want to be a child will acknowledge that. I was just read on the air the other day, Time Magazine published a survey done around around the Western world at least, and it was wildly disproportionate how few people thought their happiest years were when they were a kid. Overwhelmingly, they said their happiest was 30. They didn't reach their maximum happiness till 33. Doesn't mean it goes down after that, but they didn't get to any real level of happiness till 33. Now, obviously, everybody's different. I thought 33 was great. I remember being particularly ebullient in my 20s. I had an unhappy childhood, as it happens. It's one of the reasons I could write a book, Happiness is a Serious Problem. If happiness came totally naturally to me, like breathing, how could I give anybody advice? The whole point, I have a happy demeanor. It is worked on. And by the way, the benefits I will come to. But let me deal with this inauthentic argument. It's inauthentic. Yes, it's inauthentic in the sense that it's not how you feel, but let me give, it's not a gross example, but it's not one I like to give to people during lunch. Bad breath and body odor are authentic. Showering and brushing are inauthentic. Why do people brush their teeth, gargle with mouthwash, chew mint gum, use deodorant, take a shower every day? You don't have to shower every day. It's not a hygiene thing. You could shower very rarely and be just as healthy, but you would stink. Now, here's the thing. You don't care if you stink. That's one of God's gifts to us. We are not repelled by our own odors. But everybody else is. So you brush away, you shower away your bad odors. So too, you should shower away and brush away your bad mood. That's all. It's the same thing. I see no difference whatsoever. You want to be authentic? It's authentic to belch and flatulate. That's really authentic. He's inauthentic. He holds back his farting. I would tell you. Any of you who have raised little boys, you know how long it takes to tell them not to fart in public. My boys would go in the living room, spread their cheeks, and make the sound. They thought it was the funniest thing in the world. And to an 8-year-old boy, it is the funniest thing in the world. Except if you didn't teach them not to, they would do it at 28. Let me tell you something. If your husband doesn't do that, you should give him a hug today. I just want you to know. He has suppressed a lot by not doing that. It's very hard to make a man a civilized man. So this inauthentic thing doesn't work. That doesn't mean that you hide from your closest friends an unhappy feeling that you have. I have extremely close friends. I don't know how you get through life without close friends. I am now blessed, and I've had my difficulties in this arena, but I am now blessed truly with an extraordinarily wonderful wife and happy marriage. But I understand that people may not be. And in life, you can't act on how you feel. You have to brush it away, as it were, and you have this objection of the inauthenticity. And my friends, I want you to say what's bothering you to your husband or to your wife. I want you to tell your best friends, you know, I'm having real issues with the kids or with the kid, or I'm having real issues with whatever. I think that if couples opened up about their marriage to one couple or two couples, a lot of divorce would be obviated, would be reduced. And you know why? Because most, not all, I believe in divorce when things get terrible, but a lot of problems are universal. I always give this example of, it's in the book too, I make up these two couples, couple A and couple B. So a couple A, they're going to meet for dinner at a restaurant, the two couples. Couple A has a big fight. They don't talk to each other in the car. They're angry at each other. They get to the restaurant. Couple B, coincidentally, also had a very big fight. Don't talk to each other, angry at each other in the car. The two couples meet at the restaurant and the conversation goes as follows. Hey, how you doing? Great, great. How you doing? Great, great. During dinner, honey, is this delicious? Sweetheart, could you pass the salt? Honey, this is some restaurant. Darling, it's really, you picked a winner. This is what happens in the cars going home. Couple A, did you see how happy couple B is? Why can't we be a little more like them? Couple B, did you see how happy couple A is? Why couldn't we be a little more like them? Now, imagine if they got to the restaurant, these are close friends after all, and the conversation went like this. Hey guys, how you doing? Well, okay, but you know what? We had a real fight, big fight prior. You did? No kidding. So did we. You did too? No kidding. What'd you guys fight about? She says I never listen when she speaks. Really? That's what she says. You're laughing, and then they would have also been laughing. So what became a terrible evening and a burden on the marriage all of a sudden became a little laughable. Maybe it's like fairly common that wives don't think their husband will listen. By the way, let me just tell you women, it's not true. No, on behalf of men, I want to make this thing clear. Don't clap yet. All right. We do listen. We just don't remember. That's because we don't remember anything anybody says. We remember stock quotes and baseball statistics. Now, you asked your husband, what did DiMaggio bat in 1950, even though he was born in 1970? He will still know. What number was Babe Ruth? Who doesn't know that? If you're an American male, you're pretty much likely to know that. Women, on the other hand, remember everything. And that's their burden. By the way, there's proof of this. This is a great, my view on studies, either they confirm what common sense suggests or they're wrong. This one was a very good study. Common sense immediately reacted and makes sense, but I didn't know it before I heard the study. I think it was University of Wisconsin, I'm not certain. Boys were taken, male students, put in alone in a room for hours. Nothing electronic, no books, nothing, just four walls and a chair. They come out, they're asked, what did you think about? Girls put in, few hours, nothing to read, nothing to look at, just four walls and a chair. What did you think about? The boys answered, sports and sex. Some of us don't understand the sports part, but that's a separate issue. And the girls, this was what, the boys is not revelatory. It usually elicits a yawn. The girls reviewed conversations. And I remember when I heard that, I thought, wow. Under pain of torture, I could not review a conversation. Which, by the way, has led me to a realization, and that is if we could swap brains for a day, this is what would happen. If men got a woman's brain for a day, they would all kill themselves. The noise, the sheer noise. It scares me. But if women got a men's brain, they would go, free at last, free at last. When you ask your husband, what are you thinking about, or your son, and he says, nothing, he's being truthful. You think he's trying to get around. He's not getting around anything. He was thinking of nothing. Nothing. We're very similar to dogs in that way. We just, Now, the beauty of your laughter is that this is because it's so true. Now, if couples could speak to other couples, maybe a lot of the time they'd start laughing. Because, well, maybe she's not a whatever name you want to use. Maybe he's not a whatever name you want to use. Maybe she's just female and he's just male, and it comes with the territory. That doesn't mean we shouldn't try to work on ourselves. I'm a very big believer in fighting your own nature, male or female. Of course. But still, having somebody to talk to. Therefore, when I say act despite your feelings, that doesn't mean you shouldn't relay what you feel. That doesn't mean you constantly do it. That's another thing. You tell your friends you're unhappy about something and then move on. We want friends to bring joy into our life, not misery. And that's something one has to be mature enough to understand. Where is the balance between confidentiality and openness, which there should be, and it permeate the whole thing? Let me give the worst case scenario, the loss of a child. I have talked to more people who have lost children than almost anybody, or than anybody, I think, who was not in the field. Because I have talked about it on the radio, and people have written to me, and so on. I mean, it's the nightmare of any of us who are parents, and I'm sure that there are people here who have experienced that nightmare. And I learned many years ago that it was not uncommon for people who had lost, a couple that had lost a child, to also then gradually lose their friends. When I first heard it, I thought, what kind of friends are those? They lose a child, so they abandon them? I don't understand. Now I do understand it. Some people who lose their children, and it's totally understandable, but it's not advisable, that becomes the defining element of their life. And then you aren't a joy then in your friend's life. They want to share your pain. That's why they're friends. They're not bad guys. Some people are bad guys. Most people are not bad guys. So we have our pain, and we should express it. But you can't pickle it. It's not good for you. I mean, there has to be a period of time where you're just preoccupied with such a loss. It's totally understandable. But I really do believe, yes, you do talk to your friends about your unhappinesses. You don't dwell on it. You talk about it. But beyond that, it is still how you act. And finally, let me make the selfish case. I've made the moral case. Now let me conclude with the selfish case for acting happy. First of all, there is a tremendous pleasure in bringing others happy if you're a normal person. Bringing others happiness. I'm perfectly honest with you. I get a kick out of the reactions of people in the elevator. I do. I feel better about me and about life that I have brought some cheer to utter strangers who don't know me from Adam for 30 seconds or 1 minute in an elevator. It is good for you. Because bringing joy to others is about as big a gift as you can ever give to anybody. Number two, happy people attract people. Unhappy people repel people. And everyone needs people in their lives. So here is the irony. You know, the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. The happy get happier and the unhappy get unhappier. The happy get happier because they bring all these people into their lives who want to be with them. The unhappy repel people and they're not in their lives because they don't really want to be with them. That's a very big difference. Those who are looking to get married, one of the greatest single things, one of the greatest two, three things you could do for your life is have a cheerful demeanor. It attracts people. You're married, it attracts friends. You're unmarried, it attracts potential mates. There is no argument against this that I know of, none. In every area of life, I am a behaviorist. Every area of life. Act good, you'll be gooder. Act loving, you'll be more loving. Listen, I'm a going to say something that's probably the most controversial thing I think I ever said. I wrote a two-part series. I write a column every week. It's on the internet. You can certainly easily find it. And at the end of the year, each year, I write about micro matters as opposed to what's going on in the world. And a couple of years ago, I wrote a two-part column titled, When a Woman is Not in the Mood. Let me tell you, and with this I do conclude, something I learned from a rabbi of mine in fourth grade at a religious Jewish school, and I applied it to sex in marriage. The rabbi did not have this in mind, I promise. Fourth grade, the rabbi announces, "All right, boys, it is time for the afternoon prayers." I walked over to him, fourth grade, and I said, "Rabbi Fosdag, excuse me, I'm not in the mood for afternoon prayers." The rabbi he had never heard mood and prayer in the same sentence. So he was clearly flummoxed. And then finally he said, "Dennis Prager is not in the mood for the afternoon prayers? So what?" The man changed my life. I'm still not in the mood for afternoon prayers, but he did. He changed my life. This is very important. It's the only thing I remember from fourth grade. But it changed my life. That's the answer to most moods. So what? Including sex in marriage, if you're married to a good man and all the other things that are around it. And I'm not talking every time, and I'm not talking if you're, you know, just in a terrible mood from the kids or beyond tired or sick or obviously there are all sorts of factors. But all things being considered, mood can't be the only reason. It's not a good idea. Because the effect on your marriage and on him is so positive for you to give in that arena that why would you allow mood to stop? As I said, and forgive the metaphor, crucified on the internet for this, which I expected, it's fine. Because I made the analogy, what if your husband woke up and said, "I'm not in the mood to go to work"? Is every man or every woman in the mood to go to work every day? I am, but I'm abnormal. Not only abnormal, I have an abnormal job, all right? I'm very blessed. I can't imagine a more wonderful job. Tell people what you think for 3 hours, go around the country and say it. I mean, it's like a dream. I admit it. Every day I pinch myself. I do. But I totally understand that. Every day you're going to be in the mood. What do we do that's good just based on the mood? Maybe if you're in the mood for Indian food rather than Chinese food, then have Indian food. It has no effect on anybody. But where it has an effect on others, mood can't direct you. So I'm a behaviorist. Ralph Fine was the Nazi commandant in Schindler's List. Schindler's List. He was interviewed in the New York Times at the time, and he said, "I can't wait till this film shooting is over." And the interviewer said, "Why?" He said, "Because I'm getting meaner." That was powerful. He acted like a Nazi in a movie, reading lines. He's an actor. And it was making him meaner. Off the set. And who was Moses again in Ten Commandments? Charlton Heston. Charlton Heston and I were somewhat friendly. He was the only actor that I actually did end up close with. We had similar views on a lot of things, and he listened to the show, invited me to lunch, and we had a relationship. And I asked him once, I said, "I'm curious, I'll never forget this, did acting Moses affect you off and after the movie?" He said, "Absolutely. I felt that I had an image to maintain, and I couldn't be irresponsible to it." And he led a particularly wonderful, fine, decent life for that world and for any world. How you act, even in movies, can affect who you are as a person. So I say to you, act happy despite how you feel. You will make the world better, you will make everybody around you better, and yes, you will make you better. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.